Hey, it's Scott, and welcome to the very first episode of How to Get Good, today featuring the Curved Dragon Greatsword. This is going to be a series with as many parts as there are weapons in Dark Souls 2, or at least that's the plan, and basically in each video I'm just going to quickly go over a lot of easy-to-use tactics that you can use in PvP, and basically overall how to be better versing players with the weapon that the episode is currently about. So, here is the Curved Dragon Greatsword. First, I'll quickly go over the pros and cons of the weapon, and I plan to do that with every weapon, just to start it off to get a good overall picture of what it does. So the good things, it has a B scaling in strength and an S scaling in dexterity, meaning that on an actual 40-40 build, which means 40 strength and 40 dexterity, it actually has over 600 pure physical damage. That's including the Ring of Blades, even plus one, it has over 600. Which is a lot, and especially when you're versing people in a higher soul memory that always use Great Magic Barrier, just 600 pure physical damage is actually really, really good. It also has a really cool R2 that shoots out a bunch of projectiles that is usually used after a combo to catch the opponent off guard when they're rolling away from you. Also, it has a pretty decent parry animation for a curved greatsword, so we'll get into that in a little bit. Unfortunately, the Curved Dragon Greatsword also has a fairly strange attack arc from the top left down right. You need to be able to aim that very well to actually hit it. And just the standing still R1s are very easy to roll through. They have a significant wind-up time. And overall, the weapon has a fairly high stamina usage, especially if you're two-handing it. Although the weapon does do a lot of damage when you hit somebody, you have to actually hit them to do the damage. And with this sword, it's a little bit harder than just a quick long sword or something like that. So you have to do a little bit more than just spam R1s to actually hit an enemy. The first thing you can do is try baiting them into you. You can feign a more defensive position, and when they're in range, or about to be in range by the time your R1 would actually hit the ground, then you swing. Unfortunately, this doesn't work against some weapons, especially the katana's R1 poke, because it'll stun you out of your attack animation while you're preparing it as they're coming into you, so you'll need to do something else to actually reliably damage them. Probably my favorite tactic on any curved greatsword, but especially this one, is the running backstep into attack. The maneuver is pretty simple to do. You just run up to an opponent, and then take your hand completely off the analog stick as to not roll, press circle to backstep, and then immediately follow it up with an attack. Usually, this actually takes the opponent's understanding of your weapon into your advantage, because they know it's slow and they can damage you and stun you out of your animation before you can actually hit them. So when you're running into them, they're preparing an attack, but then you backstep, they miss, and then you swing and hit them. It'll usually work at least once during the fight. After that, they might start getting wary of it, but it's almost a guaranteed 4, 5, 600 damage on any opponent. Another thing people don't really expect with a two-handed large sword like this is parries. And for some reason, the Curved Dragon Greatsword has a pretty decent parry animation. It's about on par with parrying with like a normal shield, not like a buckler or anything, but the Drangleic shield or anything like that. So if you time it pretty much before they start their attack, or right when they're going to do a roll attack, when they start the roll, you can parry pretty well. It has a fairly large window and it's pretty forgiving, so people definitely don't expect that at all. This tactic is in regards to the R2 shockwave attack, that it looks really cool, but you need to use it right. You should never use it if they're actually using a spell, you think you can damage them before they can damage you. No, they're gonna damage you and probably stun you out of your animation. It's a very long windup. In fact, really the only time I've found the shockwave to be very useful is after you get two stun lock hits on them with an R1. Chances are they're going to immediately roll away after that. If they roll forward or backwards and then you chain an R2 after it, they're screwed. If they roll left or right, then you waste an R2 and oh well, it's not a big deal. Chances are they're not going to backstab you because you can roll out of it quick enough. But try chaining the R2 after you actually get two R1s on them, because just their human reaction will be to roll backwards and they'll roll into the shockwaves and get hit again. And lastly, my favorite part about this weapon is, if you two-hand it and just press R1, you can't be parried ever. It's really funny when they try.